I like popcorn. I like it a lot. I've seen movies where the popcorn was the best part. Now, of course, I'm married. We don't go to movies. We don't go out at all, in fact, unless there's a grease fire. So I just make my own popcorn at home. What I do is I'll take a cup of kernels like this, put it into a pot, shake her on the stove until my arm falls off, and that'll make me about a bowl of popcorn like that. But when friends or maybe Moose Thompson drops over, well, I need to make a bigger batch. You know, I'm thinking, I need a machine to do the work for me. You know, that's exactly what happened in the Industrial Revolution. I need something industrial that has revolutions. I'm thinking clothes dryer. Pop a stick of butter into the lint filter, and it's showtime. Big week up at the lodge this week. It's the annual Possum Lake Sausage Carnival. Send in your homemade sausage, bratwurst or knackwurst or whatever, and the judges decide who has the best worst. We enter it every year, but the guys at Caribou Lodge always beat the stuffing out of us, but I got a feeling that this year is our year.
Well, I got the sausage casing.
Wow. That's a pretty big wad of tubing you got there. Where'd you get that?
Well, you know, I know a guy who works at the experimental farm.
How did that experiment go, do you think?
I have no idea, Red, because, you know, when a guy hands you 50 foot of intestine on a silver platter, you don't want to ask questions.
No. No, you don't look a gift horse in the mouth, huh?
You're not even close.
All right, fine. Like I'm saying, our chances of winning the sausage carnival are better than ever.
Yeah, and the winner gets his picture in the paper, posed tastefully beside his sausage, yeah. Plus a year's supply of bicarbonate of soda.
Yeah. And you get to wear the sausage crown, which is, it's a hat shaped like a crown covered with sausage. I probably figured that one out already.
We haven't won yet.
No, I know, and we better get packing. Gonna take a fair whack of mystery meat to stuff that puppy.
No guts, no glory.
Oh, man.
Send him in. Mr. Green.
Yeah.
Thank you for coming in. I'm Kelly Cook.
All right.
You know, you are a lot older than I had been expecting.
Isn't this a school day, huh?
I'm the new programmer here at the network.
Oh.
Please have a seat.
All right.
Now, I have a few suggestions for your show. Mm-hmm. And by suggestions, I do mean instructions, okay?
Have you seen my show?
Not all the way through. Let's see. First of all, the lodge itself. Yeah. How should I put this? It's gross. It needs to be cleaned up.
Okay.
Okay, or destroyed. It's up to you.
All right.
Okay? Yeah. Secondly, let's say this over here is political correctness.
All right.
And this over here is political incorrectness.
Gotcha.
You're about beyond that wall over there.
Oh.
Okay, Mr. Green, shouldn't you be writing this down?
Well, actually, I can't read my writing very well.
Okay. Well, it'll be in the next memo anyways.
All right.
I'm also looking for some increased safety awareness on your little, hobby fix-it things.
Okay.
A man like you holding a power tool is not a comforting image for our audience.
Well, I was just having a little fun, you know.
You're too old to be having fun, Mr. Green. Oh, and one more thing. There seems to be this grayish silvery tape all over everything on your show. Yeah, it's disgusting. If you need us to fire some of your technical people, we will. Okay,
so no duct tape, no handyman corners, no lodge.
Perfect.
Well, that shouldn't be a problem.
Great.
Say, have you seen that new hip-hop mosh rap jam thing with Britney Spears over on Channel 97?
No yeah. way. Yeah, what time is that one?
Well, it's on in my time slot. They run it against my show.
Oh, and when is that again?
Well, 8:30 Friday night.
Excellent. That sounds excellent.
It's time for the Possum Lodge Word Game! Today's prize is from Mercury Creek Bait and Tackle. It's a complete ice fishing kit! And playing for this much sought-after prize, Mr. Mike Hammer. Close yours? Yeah. Okay, Red, you have 30 seconds to get Mike to say this word. Bye. Bye.
Yeah, all right, mister.
Bye-bye. And go.
All right, Mike, when one of your dads would leave home to go to work, you'd say, good
riddance.
Okay, in the Olympics, when a competitor is automatically put into the finals, the officials say they got a...
bribe?
Okay, now think about this. There are people who can be intimate with both men and women, right? And we say they are blank sexual.
Very.
Run out of time, run out of time.
All right, Mike, if you see something for sale in a store and it's cheaper than it should be, you say, that's a real...
steal.
No. You don't steal it, all right? What do you do?
Well, I pretend I forgot the thing was in my pocket. Sometimes the cops buy it.
There we go.
Hi, Winston Rothschild here of Rothschild Sewage and Septic Sucking Services. If you're down in the dumps because your lawn's full of lumps, call me Winston and I'll be there with my pumps.
You know, one of the major challenges that faces any handyman is how can you have some of the luxuries in life that you know you really can't afford? Like, say, a snowmobile. Well, you know the beauty and value of a snowmobile, but maybe your wife is a little reluctant to let you spend money on anything until you finish paying off that hovercraft. So this time on Handyman Corner, I'm going to show you how you can make your own darn snowmobile out of some water skis, a toboggan, a few artificial fireplace logs, and a hot water heater. This here is really the engine for the unit. A rocket engine. It's a steam rocket engine. I went with 50 gallon. You could go 60, but that would just be showing off. Okay, first thing you want to do is punch a hole in the end of her here, somewhere up high. This is your steam port, and that's where the steam's going to come out. So you got to make the hole high, otherwise the water will all leak out. Right up in here. Oh, man. Now, wait now. I got an idea. Handyman never panics. The problem is just an opportunity waiting to happen. Always. Lay that in there. Make a little adjustment. Perfect. All right, now you want to attach the power plant to the toboggan, and you got to have something that'll hold everything together, plus be able to withstand the shock of a ski jump or perhaps the insensitive comments of neighbors. I recommend the handyman's secret weapon, duct tape. All right, these artificial logs are basically my rocket fuel. Yeah, they burn for 6 hours, you know, which will get me all the way to Port Asbestos and back. If I was only going one way, I'd cut them in half. I like using the artificial logs, though, because they light up no problem, and they give off those colored flames a lot easier for the rescue plane to spot. Okay, that's the power plant done, Honor. And this baby will go faster than a teenager's allowance. Now all we gotta do is add the steering, which is basically me sitting on the front wearing a pair of water skis. I mean, is that brilliant or what, huh? You know, it's that kind of simplicity that makes me what I am. guy who's waited in his car while his wife goes into a store just for a minute knows the difference between the ways men and women shop. See, a man is sort of like a planner. You know, long before he goes to the store, he knows exactly what he wants. He knows exactly where to get it. The last thing he wants is to get stuck in some embarrassing corner of the store where they have underwear or curtains. Because when a guy goes shopping, he wants to look cool. You know, like the shopping experience is no stress to him whatsoever. His wife, however, tends to be a little looser. She'll go to a store with no idea what it is that she needs. She'll figure out what it is she desperately wants after she gets there. She's more open. She's more receptive. She's nicer. She'll read all the labels from 6 different kinds of toothpaste. She'll try on every size 8 shoe in the store. She'll listen to the entire gastrointestinal history of the salesperson's dog. Centuries from now, I figure archaeologists are going to uncover some guy still sitting in his car by the curb, waiting for his wife who went into the store just for a minute. Remember, I'm pulling for you. We're all in this together. You know, I've met people who don't appreciate sausages. I never really understood why. They say to me, well, it's pig's entrails stuffed with fatty meat and suet. And I say, yeah. But after what I've been through today, I'm starting to lose my enthusiasm for it, to be honest with you.
Where did you go?
Well, Dalton, I didn't mind helping you stuff the thing, but when you tied that knot in the end, I thought I was gonna lose it.
You're not having second thoughts, are you?
I'm not having any thoughts.
Well, good. Because if we want to beat those yahoos down at Caribou Lodge, we've got to get this down to the sausage carnival. And tonight's the cook-off.
Well, you're not putting that in my van, I'll tell you that. We can't just drag it down there. We might snag a nail. We don't have a spare.
Yeah, maybe we could float it down over the lake. You know, you think the water would ruin the flavor?
Nothing would ruin that flavor. Well, I got an idea. Take a couple of boat trailers, put them end to end behind the possum van, just lay the sausage right over the whole deal there.
Well, what if the cops stop us?
Well, we'll tell them it's a biodegradable telephone pole.
You know what you could say?
What?
I bet you never sausage a thing.
Don't make me kill you, Dalton. What?
How's it going, Red?
Catch me, will ya? Thanks for your help there, Dwight. Sorry for the inconvenience.
I'm in the service business, Red.
Yeah? Well, good. Because this outboard you sold me isn't working.
No reason to raise your voice, Red.
Well, that's right. You don't have to hear me over the sound of a motor or anything, do you? It keeps cutting out on me. Especially in the wet weather, and of course, you rained last night over at the lodge. Did it rain here at all? Are you telling me you're too lazy to even get out of the rain?
I prefer to call it passive environmental interaction.
Well, whatever you call it, I need you to fix this outboard that you sold me.
How much did I sell it to you for?
$75.
Well, that was a good deal.
You want to buy it back?
No chance.
So what do we do now?
Okay, I guess if you want to carry it up into the shop, I might try and take a look at it.
You expect me to carry the motor that you sold me to the shop by myself?
Can you hear yourself, Red? It's all me, 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 like you were the center of the universe. And that tone, you sound like a heart attack just waiting to happen.
Well, you know, Dwight, I don't think anybody on the verge of a heart attack should be carrying an outboard by himself.
Don't look at me. Heart disease runs in my family.
Man, nothing runs in your family, Dwight. That's why they all have heart attacks. How soon do you have this thing fixed, Dwight?
Oh, hard to say. This is our busy time.
A bunch of us were out in Dalton's car, and he was having some kind of an emergency, and Turned out to be some type of fire going on in the groinal crotchal area. That is, you really don't want to have that in your driver. I don't know. So I had the thermos of I believe that was ice water. Yeah, it did the job. And of course Walter had another plan, but I said no. And then he found, apparently, this Mike had thrown that out the window and it went right in. That's unfortunate. No, it's out, Mike. It's out, Mike. It's out. Now, unfortunately, we had jumped out of the car so quickly, and we had all locked our doors and the windows were up. And that's not the worst part. She was running. So Dalton's wasting gas by the second. He's trying it all. It doesn't leave us. Got to try all the doors himself. Well, we got to try something here. What are we going to do? And I said, I'm telling Walter, if he gets some kind of wire, we go down through the window, hook on. So he sees a wire fence. And of course, the sign we knocked over turned out to be important. And Walter had me, oh. And of course, we're not paying any attention to him. And all of a sudden, oh. So I decided to go with plan B on that. Took the guys over. Dalton wanted to work on it himself, but easy, Walter, easy. Thought we'd get something we could maybe break into the car in another way. And yeah, give us a... Oh, gosh, you just moved out of the way, Dalton. Dalton's up. What are you so upset about? Not that big a dent. What's your problem, Dalton? Oh, your wife's car. All right, I got an idea. We can just stick a rock into the exhaust pipe, and that'll... Oh, that's hot. That's hot. Oh, that's hot. Well, Mike's got the rubber gloves on. Is that a summer job, Mike, or what is that? So he's gonna... The thing is, it'll make the... It'll stall the engine. Jam that in there. Now, the engine will stall. Well, one of two things will happen. One of them will be the engine will stall. And this is the other. Oh, well, all right, this gave me an idea. I saw the rubber gloves, and I'm thinking, you know, something with a little give to it, and I'll duct tape that on there. And it's filling up pretty good with exhaust. Now, I'm expecting that the engine's gonna conk out any second, but the glove's getting bigger and bigger, and we didn't know what to do, and suddenly I thought, what would my grandfather do? He'd say, pull my finger. Mission accomplished. You know, the hardest part about washing a car is bending over and doing the wheels. Here's a shortcut for you. Soap them up real good, then get yourself a bowl of horse meat. This is one I bet on last week. You also need a friendly dog with a great big bushy tail. Damn. Boy, now, if he could only find some way of rinsing off when he was done.
Lucky to be alive.
Well, I don't know. That's too close to call.
What happened exactly? It's all a blur.
Well, do you remember how we laid the sausage out on the grills, all those barbecues set up end to end?
Yeah, I remember that part, and I remember the smell of it cooking.
Everybody in the Tri-County area remembers the smell. They thought the pulp mill had reopened. Remember how the pressure built up inside the sausage?
Yeah. Yeah, it got real big, just like the Hindenburg.
That's right. Then you went and poked a hole in the end with that fork.
Oh, the humanity.
Apparently, we didn't get the interior of the sausage as sterile as it needs to be. Getting a methane buildup in there. Those of you in a college fraternity know that methane is flammable.
I remember a hot blast of fetid air and then something went off like a firecracker.
More of a cruise missile, really. We still don't know where it came down.
Boy, it was lucky it arced over the crowd.
Yeah.
Otherwise, people could have been seriously sausaged.
Yeah, it was bad.
Yeah, it was the worst. Oh, it's meeting time.
Yeah, you go ahead, wiener boy. So if my wife is watching, I'll be coming straight home after the meeting. And it turns out that all those things you said about men and sausages are absolutely correct, and let's just leave it there. And to the rest of you, thanks for watching. On behalf of myself and the whole gang up here at Possum Lodge, keep your stick on the ice. Bow your heads from man's prayer. I'm a man,
but I can change. If I have to, I guess.
Hey, guys, I know you're all disappointed about the sausage carnival and so on, but Winston has a little bit of good news for us.
Yeah, guys, well, as you know, our sausage didn't really impress the judges, but it scored a hit with the Caribou Lodge. A direct hit!